Good morning and welcome to Canyon Hills. If you're worshiping with us here in person, we're so grateful that you're here. If you're watching across the street at the summit, we want to say hi. You guys are in for a treat this morning. As you know from the beginning of service, we're shining a light this weekend on human trafficking and what we can do as a church to stop human trafficking. And so to that end, we have a wonderful guest speaker with us this morning. Her name is Angel Barnett. Angel and her husband Luke for 26 years have pastored some of the leading churches in this nation, including Dream City Church. Many of you guys are familiar with Dream City Church. We've been there many times, and that church has been such an influence on us with their founding pastor, Pastor Tommy Barnett, which is Angel's father-in-law. We're so grateful for them, for the legacy that they have imparted to us in so many churches across this nation. Angel and her husband, Luke, as they lead Dream City Church, they are intentional about building the kingdom of God, innovation, and also community transformation, which we just have such a heart for as well. Angel had an opportunity in 2018 to be exposed to the Short Creek Ranch, which you're going to hear a lot more about today, which is on the border of Arizona and Utah. And it was a fundamentalist Baptist polygamous cult, one of the largest in the nation. Mormon. Fundamentalist Mormon cult. Let me get excuse me, pardon me. Oh my goodness. It was a cult, which you're going to hear more about today, that left people and also the surrounding community devastated. Angel and her team have been able to go in and just bring healing and hope through Jesus Christ to that area, to those people. And we're so thankful. My dad's about to come take the mic from me, I think. This might be the last time you see me up here. I'm so sorry. Oh, goodness. It's going to be a fun day. Through this project, Angel founded Dream Institute, which is one of the leading nonprofits to rescue people from human trafficking, minister to them and their families, not only nationally, but also globally around the world. She just returned from Ukraine with our team through CityServe, where she partnered, ministered to women over there. You are going to be so blessed by her ministry today. Would you please give a warm Canyon Hills welcome to Angel Barnett?
I loved it! Good morning, Canyon Hills. Oh my gosh. Thank you, Jen, because that just made it fun. Right? I mean, not for the Baptists here. Sorry about that. But thank you. I mean, your hospitality, Jen, I adore you, Pastor Wendell and Linda, Canyon Hills. This is an activistic church. I am at home. Our Dream City Church is also outreach oriented. And thank you. Just to be clear, if this goes horribly wrong, I called Pastor Wendell. He did not call and invite me. I inserted myself on you. He's very gracious, I know, because he loves Pastor Tommy Barnett. So I am honored, humbled to be here with you. I'm so excited about today and really excited that you guys have had me on a month where you are activistically showing people about what's going on with human trafficking in your town. What a beautiful town and community you have. Every town needs Jesus, but to bring awareness to what goes on in our world, in our cities and communities in regards to human trafficking. Thank you for what you are doing, Canyon Hills, so activistic worldwide, globally, but in your own community. So I'm amazed by you. Well, today, I'm going to speak to you on the topic of being a difference maker. Let me pray for you. Lord, we just thank you for this day, that the hearts and minds would be open, that the Holy Spirit would individually go into each person and speak and whisper what you are wanting them to hear and engage in today. May my words not be mine, but yours. Holy Spirit, may you flow and speak through me. Thank you for this opportunity to share. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, I did marry into a family of difference makers. No pressure here. We start with Pastor Matthew Barnett from Los Angeles. He was barely out of diapers, and the Barnetts threw him into the thralls of the inner city of Los Angeles to start a church and a dream center with his dad. And I mean, what kind of family sends a kid over there at 17 years old, doesn't fit in at all? Here you go. Good luck. He must have had nobody to send over there. Pastor Tommy just sends his youngest son, and Matthew killed it. I mean, what a calling, what a difference maker Matthew is. Then you have my husband, incredible husband. I love Luke Barnett so much. He just gives me such a confidence to be able to do things I thought I'd never be able to do. He has taken over his father's legacy by leading Dream City Church and expanding 8 campuses beyond the initial campus. And Luke is just an incredible difference maker. And then Tommy Barnett. I could go on for an hour. What a difference maker, a legacy builder, and he is an out-of-the-box ministry thinker. All the ripple effect of bus ministry, innovative way of bringing a message, illustrated sermons, a creative way of bringing the Bible to life through illustrated sermons, and then the pastor's school, now called Dream Conference. What an exciting way we're able to say that people like T.D. Jakes and Jensen Franklin, Dave Donaldson and Pastor Wendell Benson came at the origin of these conferences. And then today, the ministries and churches that are birthed out of those conferences, we're able to say Pastor Tommy Barnett is definitely leaving a legacy. So with that said, no pressure being born into a or married into a family of difference makers, but that raises and sets the bar. So I am grateful for it. I believe that deep down inside of every human being is the desire to make a difference. A question that intrigues me about every difference maker is what precedes vision? Because if you go to a conference, a leadership conference, vision is at the top of the list. And vision is a powerful weapon in your arsenal. But my question is, what happens inside of every difference maker that is so powerful that it eventually gives birth to a vision that then a person can act on? Billy Graham is one of the greatest difference makers the world has ever known. For most of his adult life, he traveled the world filling stadiums with people knowing the love of Jesus. But my question is, what happened inside of his heart before he held his first crusade? Because what happened inside of him must have been so powerful that it gave birth to the vision of renting out the very first stadium, filling it with all those hundreds of thousands of people coming to know Jesus. Because whatever experience happened inside of him must have been powerful. I believe in the heart of every difference maker, there is a powerful firestorm experience that sort of shoves them into the vision that then a difference can be made. Most historians would agree that Moses, one of the greatest leaders ever known, the powerful firestorm experience that happened inside of Moses that shoved him into be a difference maker. Exodus 2:11. One day after Moses had grown up, he went out to where his own people were and watched them at hard labor. Now time out. Moses was not an Egyptian. He was raised by Pharaoh's daughter in the palace, accustomed to the wealth and privilege of an Egyptian upbringing. So the text goes on to say, Moses went out to see his own people who were doing hard labor because the Egyptians had enslaved the Jewish people and working them tirelessly and mercilessly. While he watched this, verse 11, he saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his own people. Question, has anyone ever seen a physical beating up close and personal? Some of you are raising your hands. Most of us probably have only seen it in the movies. I can't imagine the sights and the sounds personally up close. If you see something like that, you can't unsee it. Even in the movie theaters, we tend to turn our heads. We don't want to see that, and it still sticks in our memory, the sights and sounds of a physical beating. Moses is watching an Egyptian man beating one of his own people who have already been worked to the bone. Moses could not take the injustice anymore. The sights and sounds, the splattering of blood were too much. Something snapped inside of him. Verse 12 goes on, looking this way and that, and seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. So Moses comes to the defense of his countrymen. He pulls the Egyptian off the Hebrew man. Moses continues to fight the Egyptian, kills him, buries him in the sand. So I think the takeaway today is don't mess with Moses. Verse 13 says, next day he went out and saw two Hebrews fighting and asked the one in the wrong, why are you hitting your fellow Hebrew? So the very next day, poor Moses goes out and he's looking at his people being beaten and oppressed, and he sees the same sights and the same sounds. Moses breaks up the fight and asks, why are you doing this, beating your fellow Hebrew? Our people are getting beat up every day by the Egyptians. Why are you fighting each other? Here's what I think happened in this inside of Moses as he walked out and saw his people being beaten every day. It took him to the absolute edge of his emotional limits, and he said, I just can't take this anymore. This is madness. And Moses snapped. Pharaoh heard what Moses had done, and he tried to kill him. So Moses ran to the desert. So we fast forward to the burning bush experience found in Exodus 3. Moses came to a burning bush in the middle of the desert. It was on fire, but it was not consumed. And a voice came from the burning bush. It said, Moses, take off your sandals, for you are standing on holy ground. You know, as a kid, I always thought it was the shock and awe of the burning bush that made Moses, shoved him into being a difference maker. But you know, in further reflection, I'm thinking it was an attention grabber to slow Moses down, because what God was going to say to Moses was already going to resonate with Moses. It was already in his heart. And what God was going to say to Moses was going to shove him into being a difference maker. Exodus 3, 7 through 10, the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. In other words, God is saying, I have seen the same sights and the same sounds, and I am concerned about their suffering. And now the cry of the Israelites have reached me, and I've seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. Please understand what is happening here. God said, Moses, what you have been seeing and hearing is what I have been seeing and hearing. I'm going to do something from heaven. I am assigning you to be my agent of change on earth, and I am choosing you because I see you are stirred in your spirit about the same things that are stirring me. You have a passion in you for your people, a capacity for activism. You're a man who cannot stand idly by. When his people are being beaten and oppressed, you are a man that I have been looking for. So Moses, I'm going to take a firestorm of internal frustration that is raging inside of you, and I'm going to use it for a positive way. I'm going to build fortitude, character, and leadership in you and raise you up to be a difference maker. And you will set my people free. This is the key to understanding what it takes to be a difference maker. When God's heart and a human heart aligns around something that frustrates heaven and earth to a point of absolute angst, that's when a difference maker is born. So growing up on Saturday mornings, does anyone remember the exhilarating episodes of Popeye the Sailor Man? There's a few of us older ones, not too many. We're not talking about Popeye's the food place. We're talking about the cartoon on Saturday morning. So Popeye was a sailor man in olive oil. She was quite tall and gangly. She was quite horrible looking, but she was the thing. And when she walked by, dogs barked and men whistled. And when anything would come under threatening the well-being of olive oil, Popeye's blood pressure would rise. I'm seeing some heads nod. Yes, they remember this. And he would say those words that a whole generation of Americans have burned into our brain. If anyone knows it, that's all I can stands. I can't stands no more. The young people are looking at like, who is this lady? Get her off the stage. It was a thing, people, you young people. Questionable grammar, I know, but at least he's a sailor and not cussing, so we have that going for us. He would pop open a can of spinach, supernatural power would flow to his forearms, and he would crush the opposition. Saving sweet olive oil, those were the good old days. Clean, safe cartoons, don't get me going. That line, "That's all I can stand, I can't stand no more," means something to a difference maker, because it was probably something that they saw or heard that they couldn't stand and prompted them to get off of their backsides and move toward the achievement of something worthwhile and eternal. Question, what can't you stand? Because whatever it is often creates the burden inside of you, the angst, the activism, the firestorm of frustration inside of you that God will speak to you about, that eventually launches you into becoming a difference maker. I'll call it this morning your divine disruption. What is your divine disruption? Let me tell you about a history difference maker with a divine disruption. Her name was Harriet Tubman. She couldn't stand the slavery, abuse, and opposition she and so many others were under. The sights and the sounds of slavery pushed her to her emotional limit, and she said, "That's all I can stand." Harriet Tubman had a divine disruption that birthed the vision that she acted on and was truly a difference maker. She escaped to find her own freedom. But that wasn't good enough for Harriet. She went back on 13 risky missions to rescue 70 of her friends and family. But that wasn't good enough. Because of her knowledge of the lay of the land, the army employed her to go back, and together they were able to free over 700 people from slavery. But that wasn't good enough for Harriet Tubman. She offered her services to care for wounded soldiers. A person who finds what we would call freedom to do what we want to do, what she found was true freedom rests in serving people. Being a difference maker is true freedom. The angst we feel by our culture surrounding us, constricting us, is exploded. The chains come off when you find the true freedom of being a difference maker. And that's what Harriet Tubman exampled to us all. What can't you stand? Do you know? Most people try to push away stuff that creates the internal firestorm of frustration. They feel the discomfort of it. They want to medicate it, entertain it, jump onto another job career that keeps them disconnected from the firestorm of frustration. But if you desire to be used by God as a difference maker, one of the most important questions you can answer is, what can't you stand? Is it an injustice of some kind? Poverty? Does that wreck you? Racism, abortion, human trafficking? You need to know, because it probably wrecks God too. And he is looking for someone who's getting wrecked just like he is. It doesn't matter how beautiful you are, how smart, how talented. That's not what it's about at all. God wants to align with you and give you a vision that will release the internal anxiety by getting you onto the solution side of something eternal, something that will fuel you and flow supernatural power into your life and fire you up for the rest of your life. Question, how do you develop your personal divine disruption? Point number one, every human being has a divine disruption. Now, I don't believe that every time you get a burden for a societal ill, it is automatically your God-given divine disruption. If everything bothers you while you're walking around, we just are cranky people. But as God continues to work in our lives, I think many societal ills should begin to ring our bell, break our hearts, and move us to some sort of action. I also believe that all we are looking for is that one cause, that one problem, that one situation that grabs us by the throat and won't let us go. And then you say, that is my Popeye moment. God, I'm available if you will use me. When your personal burning bush moment occurs, you'll know it. And you'll sense God saying to you, this is why I have wired you up
the way I have. This is why I've given you the life experiences I have given you, allowed you to travel the world, see the things that I've allowed you to see. I believe there is one divine disruption with your name on it. Second point, don't give up on looking for your divine disruption because it's never too late to be used by God. One day there was an old donkey. He felt his best years were behind him. He was tired. He was old. He laid down and died. The coyotes came along. They did what they do. The birds came along. They did more. The ants came along and they cleaned him up really good. Then there was a booming voice from heaven that said, "All right, is everyone done with that old donkey? Because I'm not. His finest hour is in front of him." Just then, Samson comes along, picks up the bone of that donkey, and kills 1,000 men with it. We are not the one that says when our finest day is over. It may very well be in front of you. Sometimes as we get older, we start to buy the lie that exposes our heart and says our best years are behind us. Keep exposing your heart, your eyes, your ears to the pain in our world. Travel more. Press in, go into the inner city and get amongst the poor. God will cause a passion to rise up inside of you for your Popeye moment. And you'll say, "Now, there's something I can't let go. There's something I have to do it about, make it about." Pastor Tommy Barnett was 56 years old when he had his divine disruption, when God just then called him to Los Angeles. By then, you think you're coasting. You've raised an incredible church. Things are good. Why on earth would he want to start from scratch, go into a city that was not his? He accepted the call. The Dream Center, Los Angeles, was born. And there, from that, find a need and fill it, find a hurt and heal it. People took that vision, and 300 Dream Centers have erupted all over the country and the world from that. I was 47 when I found my divine disruption. Let me tell you, everybody, the older you get, the better it gets. And I can't say that I would have said that before 47, because until you get bit with that thing, and it's so good, it just gets better, and it's exciting. And that's the excitement that God wants for all of us. My third point, when you find your divine disruption, feed it, don't flee it. Feed it, don't flee it. Most of the time when we see something uncomfortable, we try to get away from it, medicate it, go see a movie, shop it away. Get out of our minds is what we're saying. But if you want to find your divine disruption, the best thing you can do is move toward the area of unrest until you have a clear direction from God as to what direction you should take to resolve it. I'm going to share with you, I had mentioned my divine disruption, about an amazing group of people I came in contact with. Just explain our larger network that was birthed out of Dream City Church by my father-in-law's vision. Of course, the Los Angeles Dream Center was like the mothership. But in Phoenix, we have the Phoenix Dream Center that houses 375 people off the street going through rehabilitation, addiction. There's a human trafficking floor for men, boys and women separated that has caused the human trafficking task force group to come and ask why we were able to have a 94 percentile of success rate with a year and a half after graduation. So they came and put into certain policies that they saw at the Phoenix Dream Center exercised by truly recovered human trafficked victims. And we also have Streetlight USA, which is an underaged relief organization where we work with Homeland Security and FBI to place girls that are 13 and under to have a place that is made just for them. And so our Phoenix Dream Center is for adults. We have the adolescents. And then the Short Creek Dream Center is for moms and kids healing together, for families, familial trafficking, families that have been traded and trafficked. We also have a Dream Center up in the White Mountains serving a large portion of Native American community with 3 pregnancy resource clinics connected to a house. Women who find themselves pregnant want to keep their baby, but don't have the infrastructure of
family to do so, or the resources. So we have a house that takes care of women that are pregnant and showcases how a family environment is and how we can help them through the decision of keeping their baby. Amen. Thank you. And then most recently, having an opportunity to be in Romania, two locations there. One is for, we're going to be receiving in widows and children displaced by the war, a safe place to have them restabilize and then allow them to enter back into society independent, just from the shock waves of the war. I don't have to tell this church, you are over there, you are in it. But we get to be a very small cog in the wheel, a part of the process of approaching the women and children that have been hurt over there. Another location to train pastors, to have a retreat opportunity, to bring resources of human trafficking awareness and trauma counseling resourcing. So those are gonna be just barely off the ground, so that's our newest location. Saying all that, the Short Creek Dream Center, you'll hear me say Colorado City, a lot of the documentaries were done on the Colorado City side, but it's called Short Creek because the Utah side is Hilldale. So to encompass and not exclude people as we are serving them, you'll hear me say Short Creek or Colorado City. There's a short video that I think might take away some of the complexities of the story. It's just a minute and a half long.
This man, who's 50 years old, then he turned to me and he said, "Do I kiss on my back?" I've never told my full story. I had so much abuse, so much trauma, there was no hope there.
I would put the FLDS at the extreme end of the continuum of false.
One of Jeff's is their leader.
Everything he says is in the right mind from God.
I will wear Jeff's 61. If a girl was told to marry this old man, she didn't question, and her parents didn't question. That was God's will.
Warren Jeffs is a psychopath with a predilection for preying upon children.
How does a community let a pedophile run their community and assault their children?
It's not a choice. You do it at all. I was stripped of everything he had been always. He wanted me dead. And I still have to talk about it. Because I fought to escape. I fought to get out of there.
That's the video bumper that, this is the second documentary that has been made recently. The first one is Netflix, Keep Sweet, Pray and Obey. Not that I endorse Netflix by any means, but they did do a documentary that the community deemed as the most accurate. It is quite disturbing. There's a picture of Warren Jeffs and his wives. He had 86 in total as he amassed his father's wives as well, including his own mother. So beyond disturbing. The women in that town, for over 100 years, this kind of activity has been going on, but when Warren Jeffs took the stage, the level of corruption, socialistic dictatorship took complete control. Women were property, children were for work. Every girl that could have a baby was to have one every year of her life. A child was born every 18 hours with no doctors, just nurses or midwives. The death rate was incredible. There's a child cemetery there from the polygamy Down syndrome and the inbreeding that happened naturally within a community that was 14,000 people. Only 12 men were allowed to be seed bearers once Warren Jeff was locked up in prison. So the abuse kept on getting deeper and more dark. Over 500 lost boys were cast out because they were obviously a natural sexual draw to the young girls. So many young boys were cast out and shipped to Vegas or Phoenix or Colorado where they could support themselves with their trades as they were naturally skilled to do so. The community has never let anyone in. In walks Brielle Decker, and there's a picture of the Dream Center, which was Warren Jeffs' house. Brielle Decker was the 65th wife of Warren Jeffs. She tried to escape from different compounds 10 times and was unsuccessful, and you can see her whole story on the Discovery Plus show. She escaped finally after being drugged and tied up. Long story short, she made her way to Phoenix. Someone told her about the Phoenix Dream Center. She met us. She was able to experience the true love of Jesus. Imagine if religion took away God from your life. Under the guise of religion, they were abused and told if they did not comply, they would lose their salvation. If you don't give me your 9-year-old daughter, you will lose your salvation. It is systemic. It was not a choice. Brielle Decker said, I want to give you my house. Well, she was awarded Warren Jeff's house through a judge in Alaska, and she gave the house to the Phoenix Dream Center. She goes, I needed that place when I escaped and had nowhere to go. Will you take it? We actually went to the bishops in Salt Lake City and made sure that they knew of our intent, and they gave us their nod. So the FLDS is a fundamental offbreak of the LDS religion. And they wanted something to happen good there. Yes. So amen. Amen. So we were able to take that 29,000 square foot home, renovate it. The wives that used to be there came and helped rip out carpet and sweep out the red dirt of the Zion region, and they said, we're getting the evil out of this house. They were a part of the repurposing of that house. They no longer saw it as Warren Jeff's house. This was God's house of redemption, where moms and children, amen. So we have women that are from the community that have graduated the Dream Center. One of the pictures that should come up now of a lady with Joyce Meyer, actually. Yes, Lucia was one of our first graduates. And she is now, I mean, she has found Jesus, the true Jesus, with no works to get to heaven. She is now teaching Joyce Meyer's Battlefield of the Mind in small groups. The power of the local women now being the voice takes us, the outsiders, out of the scenario. The tidal wave of God's purpose has now been put back into the hands of the community and the people. The next picture is of a lady, Sarah, who was able to get her GED, and you can see how her children are jumping up in the air, so proud of their mom, so excited. Women never allowed to learn, and we get to be a part of this. The food bank, honestly, was one of the most powerful olive branches of trust. Food was used and passed out based on your social score. So if a mom was rebellious that week, she may only get rice. If she was a good, submissive wife, she might get food, dairy, milk, eggs, meat, proteins, those sorts of things. So based on their social score, we had to be very careful with how we were able to show no strings attached to the food that we are handing out. We hand out 100,000 pounds of food a month, and that's 64% of the town. 70% of the town are 17 years and younger. So when Warren Jeffs exited, they took all their most productive producers to other cults and compounds and hid them around. Who was left behind is mothers who could not care for themselves and children and a few men. Complete devastated. The food bank allowed us to win their trust, and they began to see us as one of them. The next picture is of a live rescue. The documentaries have allowed us to, you'll see the women in the prairie dress, next slide. The documentaries have allowed us to be exposed, and the FBI is now calling our directors and asking us to help with other people that are being extracted out of different cults in the country. It's like the void that was left of Warren Jeffs is being scooped up by other people who are saying there are other women to prey upon. Just 6 months ago, there was a horse trailer carrying women
through Flagstaff. The FBI busted them. They were locked on the outside with a bucket on the inside, and they were being transported from one prophet to another. But this was actually one of the 12 seed bearers, Samuel Bateman. So we have some of his wives and actual children in the Dream Center. I was up there last week, and they are so precious. They try not to talk to you because they're really not supposed to be interacting with apostates and outsiders, and they probably feel that they have let their salvation go by being there. But we know that the Holy Spirit and Jesus can deep dive into the soul and spirit of things that humans can't do. We are called to love them and serve them, no questions asked. And then it's on God. And He is making radical changes to the depths and spirit of people's soul. And we are so grateful to be a part of this. The last picture is Luke and Constance Meredith, our co-executive directors of the Short Creek Dream Center. Because of their leadership and their experience, what God allowed them to go through. Luke was a veteran in the Army through PTSD. He got hooked on drugs, had 5 heart attacks at the age of 25 through the drugs he was using. The Phoenix Dream Center walked him through recovery. Constance was also into the Dream Center through trafficking. She led the human trafficking floor to its success rate for 7 years. And I was able to take that steal, that couple for the Short Creek Dream Center. You cannot put any person in front of a group of truly traumatized people unless you've been through something. So no matter what your deep, dark story is, you are more applicable to people's healing than those of us who have not been through anything. There's so many layers. There has never been a black person in that community. Half of our staff, person of ethnicity from different parts of the world. And that community was so excited to get to know them and love them. They're asking them to be on the city council, making decisions for a town that has never known Jesus, never seen any diversity. We have won their trust. The mayor of Colorado City, that was exiled when he was a young boy, got saved in Vegas, has been called back. He is now the new mayor, and he is from Southeastern University. He is a Christian. This is unstoppable. We talk about where the town has come from only to say how resilient the power of God and how resilient the people are and where they're going. We're proud of them. We get to be a part of their future. I personally, selfishly, have never found so much joy in my life than to stumble upon my divine disruption. What a privilege. What if all of us would take a greater risk for God rather than sticking with the status quo? Can you imagine what could be released in our city, our state, our country, our world, if all of us were operating in a fundamental state of leadership driven by everyone's divine distraction? Reminds me of Jesus' words, John 4:4. Greater is He who is in you than he who is in the world. Despair means to turn our backs on hope. That is not from God. Despair and purpose cannot live in the same vessel. That cannot live inside of you because they are opposites. 2 Corinthians 4:8. We are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, not in despair. If we still believe that with God, all things are possible. Lost people can still be found. Hungry mouths can be fed. Poor people can still be lifted out of poverty. Addiction can be broken. Relationships can be redeemed. It will take all of us finding our divine distraction. So I'll ask everyone the dangerous question this morning. What can't you stand? God is not done with you yet. We are all accountable to our calling here on earth, but we're all accountable to take as many people to our eternal home with us. That's heaven. This is temporary. Heaven is forever. And we are all accountable to that. Let me pray for you. Lord, we just thank you that you are speaking to that cause that you're drawing everyone to right now. You're whispering. It's not everything, but it's that one thing. And I pray that you would just press in and let us know what our next season looks like. The most exciting season yet, because we get to be a part of this very short time here on earth and take as many people with us to heaven as we can. We give you this day and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. Amen, amen. Give Angel another hand. Wow, what a great word. What an encouraging word today. You know, Scripture says that. Scripture says to speak up. God's talking to believers to speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, to intervene and to disrupt the injustice that is holding another down. How many of you are thankful that God's doing that in Short Creek, at Short Creek Dream Center? I am. I'm very thankful for that. Thank you, Angel. What a wonderful word. We're so thankful for Dream Center, Dream City Church. Hey, you may want to join with Linda and I in being a part of blessing and sowing into Short Creek Dream Center. I am so thankful for the women of our church, the leaders and the women in our church who in this community are fighting that injustice. Hallelujah. And I'm thankful for Dream City Church and Dream Center that is doing it there in Short Creek. And you can do that by texting DREAM to any amount, or you can go on the website and you can find DREAM there and give. And we want to give a be a blessing to Short Creek Dream Center. And I just encourage you, join with Linda and I. We're going to sow into that work. We're thankful for and are blessed by the work that's being done there.
Amen. That's right. Can you believe it is 2 weeks from today until Easter Sunday morning? It's coming so fast. And we want to make sure that you're aware of everything that we have planned for you starting next Sunday, Palm Sunday. Of course, our kids are going to join us for worship. Then on the courtyard at Fort Faith, we have free pony rides and a petting zoo for families to come and enjoy. Then the next Wednesday, our Passion Pep Rally, because everybody is on the Dream Team for Easter. Amen. That means you. So we're all going to engage, and we're going to have a pep rally so that you guys can find out ways that you can serve this Easter. Of course, our Good Friday service, sunrise, then Easter Sunday, and then the last big hurrah is the kids' Easter egg hunt, giant Easter egg hunt across the street in the tent. It's going to be fantastic. But listen, this is your, might be your divine disruption this week, looking for someone to invite to come with you this Easter Sunday so that the resurrection of Jesus Christ, Jesus can come alive in their hearts this Easter. So on your way out as you leave today, we have invite tickets that you can take with you, stick them in your pocket, in your purse, and invite someone to come with you this Easter and experience Jesus Christ. If you came prepared to give today, you can give your tithes and offerings through Smart Giving, by text or online in the offering boxes as you leave today. Our prayer leaders are going to come right now. They would love to agree with you in prayer. Maybe you need healing in your body, in your marriage, in your mind. Jesus wants to meet you here today. We would love to pray with you. Can I just bless you on the way out today as you go? Would you lift your hands? Lord, I pray for every friend Amen. That is here today. God, we thank Amen. You that you have a Amen. Divine disruption in store for us. So we're going to keep our hearts and our minds open to listen to what you have to speak to us this week. And we just pray a blessing on our friends as they go. Would you Amen. Bless them, keep them, prosper Amen. Them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Be blessed. Have a great week in the Lord. Be blessed.